Tatooine Sons, a Star Wars podcast, is a proud member of the Making Star Wars Podcast Network, the two-time winner of the Fan Favorite Podcast Network from the Star Wars Podcast Awards. To learn more, go to makingstarwars.net. Welcome, Star Wars fans, to episode 72 of Tatooine Sons. Count Dooku has been one of the most mysterious enigmas in modern Star Wars canon. Why did he leave the Order and become one of the Lost 20? How did he become the Count of Serreno? And when did he turn to the dark side? This week we'll answer many of these questions as we give our spoiler-filled review of Dooku Jedi Lost by Cavan Scott. Plus, JG Carse of the Blue Saber podcast will get our hot takes on the latest Star Wars news and rumors. And we'll celebrate Samuel the Hutt's 18th birthday and high school graduation.
Great kid! Don't get cocky!
It's time for Tatooine Sons.
It's true. It's true. All of it.
What is the name of the Porg on the Millennium Falcon?
The Force is strong in my family.
What do you think his name is? It's a big moment.
I am a Jedi, like my father before me.
Maybe Turbis?
Do or do not. There is no try.
Turbis? Pablo, if you're listening to this live stream... That Porg's name is now Turbis. It's a good Star Wars name.
We're not done yet.
These guys record an awesome podcast called Tatooine Sons. Everybody listen to it.
Welcome, Star Wars fans. This is Tatooine Sons, your weekly look on all things Star Wars from the unique perspective of a father sharing his love for the amazing space fantasy saga with his two sons. I am BB Nate, and I'm joined first by my brother, Samuel the Hutt.
Hi, Judah, Star Wars fans. Thanks for tuning in. And if you're not a Star Wars fan, then you're missing out on Dooku Jedi Lost.
Okay. Short and sweet.
Yeah, I mean, why would it need to be any more complicated?
Exactly.
And, of course, you can't have Star Wars without bizarre father figures. So on that note, here's my death bow tie Jedi guy.
So it's a bittersweet weekend. It's one of those weekends where you sit there and you think about life for me. Getting ready to go into... this is the last weekend. I sent this message to Mom this morning. Did Mom tell you what I sent her?
Nothing.
I got a little emotional this morning. And I sent her a message stating... Before I get up earlier than everybody else in the house, and I was reading my Bible and I was praying and I was just thinking about things, and I thought about how is she crying already?
No. So, well, that's not what I saw, but that's good. No, I'm just standing here. You're doing your thing, and then Mom just kind of comes to the window, stands there, and gives me this look like something happened. Maybe I don't know what, and then she just walked away.
All right.
So I'm like a little confused and worried now as to what just happened.
Okay. I think she's fine. So anyway, I was sitting there and I thought, and it struck me that this will be the last weekend that we spend together as a family, just the four of us, before you turn 18, graduate high school, kind of move into this new phase of your life. And I got a little emotional about it. And so anyway.
Okay.
But congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah. High school. Is you're done doing school. Mm-hmm. We just haven't. And since you homeschool, there's like no cap and gown like ceremony and all that, which you're not. That's not a big deal to you.
No. I really like. I couldn't care less. That doesn't sound right. I'm not super excited either way for it. I mean,
well, you've been going to college already for like a couple of years already. So, you know, for you, it's just sort of like, yeah, it's another thing that we're doing.
Right. Like, it's just another birthday. It's just another, you know, party or whatever. So it's not as big a deal to me as it would be for some other people.
But. Right. And then we've got family coming in. You got your grandparents coming in. And next weekend, we've got... Next Friday will be your birthday.
Yes.
Turn him to big 18. It's going to be a pretty mild birthday because we're going to be celebrating a week later. We'll talk about that in a second. But then you're going to be going to... Or it's Grammy's birthday on the 25th. Mm-hmm. And then Saturday is... Or Sunday is like the open house thing that we're doing, like a party here for a couple hours when people can come and wish you, you know, congratulations on your birthday. Like, that's sort of like a graduation for you. And then we got a few more days, and then your best friend is going to get ready to come out. Tell everybody about that.
Yeah, so my best friend is in California at the moment. That's where he lives. And he's coming down for a week. He gets here the 31st, and we're going to just kind of hang out, have like a really extended sleepover, and just be able to hang out for a week, and then he's got to go back. But I'm looking forward to it. It was supposed to be sort of a surprise for my birthday, but they had to like ask me if I even wanted that to happen, so it's not a surprise anymore. But
yeah,
I mean, we're both really looking forward to it, so I'm really excited.
Yeah, it's going to be pretty awesome. And the best part about it is Tristan's a massive Star Wars fan, just like you.
Yeah.
And he's actually going to be our special guest on the show the week that he's here, and he's super excited to talk about Star Wars. We're going to talk about the Clone Wars. He's him and his brothers and his dad sit around watching Clone Wars all the time. So he loves that cartoon series or that anime. Made it serious cartoon. The sound. Oh, gosh,
it wasn't Cartoon Network.
No. Well, yeah. Okay. I guess
for a while.
Yeah. So anyway, that animated series. He loves it, and I know he's looking forward to season 7. So he's going to talk all about that. Yeah. So that's pretty cool. So last weekend, why don't you give an update ever on the Mando Mercs thing that you had out there?
It's like, where are you going?
Yeah, so I mean, last week on the podcast, we mentioned that you were going to be going up and spending a day acting, or a few hours acting as a handler for a Mando Mercs event. So tell all the listeners about that.
So it was a pretty small event. It's just one they do every month that they, you know, they just sign and they're obligated to do. And there was only a couple of Mandos there. It was just me and two other guys. And then there was a X-Wing pilot. Who is a Mando, but he's also Rebel Legion. But so I just got to hang out with them for a couple hours at the Air and Space Museum. You know, they showed me the ropes, so to speak. I got to get introduced to the main leader of the clan too. So it was good. It was a lot of fun. Very educational. So it was good.
Yeah, it was good. Well, and in the meantime, BB Nate, you and I got to go do something pretty interesting with that. So tell everybody what you and I did after we dropped Sam off for the Mando Mercs deal.
So we kind of waited a little while because we were trying to figure out what to do.
Yeah.
And because we really don't know the area of...
No, we were in Denver. We live about an hour and a half south of that in Colorado Springs. So,
we decided just to find a place, and there was this Mile High Comics. That was a very big comic book store, and it said it opened at 9 o'clock on Daz Maps. So it was after 9 o'clock, so we went down and got there, and it opened at 10, and it was around 20 minutes till, so we just decided to go down to a coffee shop.
Yeah, we got some coffee. That was awesome. Yeah. You like coffee?
I do.
He doesn't get it.
You got a cafe mocha. So,
I just got what you recommended.
Wait, it was good though, wasn't it? It was similar to like an aroma, right?
Very.
Yeah, okay. So aroma is like the best coffee on earth. It's only in Israel. So anyway.
And like the coal shops in New York.
Yeah, that's true.
And so it was around 10, a little after. So we went down and went into the world's largest comic shop.
45,000 square feet, 10 million comics.
It took us an hour to walk through with a few stops here and there, but
not like heavy looking.
No, it was just like trying to take it in. It felt like I've joked about this, and Nathan laughed in the car. I felt like a nudist in a mosquito colony.
Wait, no,
I think it's the other way around.
Wait, yeah, that's wait. Reverse that. A mosquito in a nudist colony.
There you go.
A nudist.
We've got to like
make a mosquito colony.
We got to make like a T-shirt or something for you now. That is amazing. I am making a T-shirt.
Wow, that's like hell on earth, is what that is. If you're a nudist in a mosquito colony, no, a mosquito in a nudist colony. You know what you have to do. You just can't figure out where to start.
Right.
So anyway, so
we started at the variant covers that they had for sale, or just regular old comics.
Yeah, lots of Star Wars comics. Hundreds and hundreds of old classic ones.
They had a few of the comics we had in our puzzle.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That we put together a couple weekends ago. That was pretty cool.
I had issue 4 of the Return of the Jedi comic adaptation.
Yeah, it was pretty awesome.
They had a lot of cosplay.
Cool. It was really awesome. Lots of collectibles, lots of fun. And then after that, we went to an 80s, 90s retro arcade called Hyperspace, where it was like, you know, you pay a flat fee to get in, and you get to play the games as long as you want throughout the rest of the day. So we played games for a while on that, and actually that's going to be part of your birthday in a couple
weeks. Yeah, that's
weekends.
Pretty much going to be my party. I'm going to have three friends.
After your friend gets here.
Yeah. Right, yeah, when Tristan's here. I'm going to have three friends. We're going to go up to Denver. We're going to go to Casa Bonita, which is like
a touristy trap thing. And if you've ever been to Casa Bonita,
it's a tourist trap.
Yeah,
it's a tourist
trap.
It's fun. And then we're going to go down to the arcade and play for a while. We might do the comic shop if we can fit it in, but
That's pretty cool. And then the last thing on the list before we kind of get into the show is we want to celebrate a really neat accomplishment or a recognition for us. This week we were listed on Feedspot.com's top 25 Star Wars podcasts among some of the podcasts we've been listening to for years now. Star Wars Underworld, of course, which we wouldn't even be doing this podcast without them.
That's true.
Initiating that. Making Star Wars as a Network is listed on there. The Making Star Wars Podcast Network, which we're also
technically like number three.
Yeah, they were number four on that. Yeah.
In that respect,
Steel Wars is on there. Resistance Broadcast, Full of Sith. What are some of the others? Star Wars Report, Star Wars Minute. Some of the big ones are on there.
Rogue
and
One,
we've got,
I think.
Rogue One Podcast, as well as Rogue Squadron, which is part of the Commonwealth that we were a part of.
Oh, yeah.
And we were excited to be listed as the number eight podcast on their list, their top 25 list. And so, yeah,
it was pretty crazy. I'm still confused as to how
this is madness.
A, we're on that list, and B, we're so high up. Like,
yeah, exactly. So I guess before we go into the podcast poll of the week, we'll just say,
be careful not to choke on your aspirations.
Yeah. And great kid, don't get cocky.
Oh, you want to do that one too?
Because it fits.
Great kid, don't get cocky.
Are you brainless?
I never ask that question until after I've done it.
What?
No! Okay, last week's... I'm going to get that right at the end of the show.
Hey,
last week's podcast poll of the week results, we asked, you know, it's interesting how everything sort of took on a new life since we put the episode out there.
Yeah,
it's because they were like, these guys made a podcast about it, now we gotta...
Well, we are the number eight podcast in the entire Star Wars universe.
Great kid! Don't get cocky!
So apparently they were listening and they figured... Bob Iger decided that it was time to go ahead and clear this up because he listened to our episode and realized that...
You're right.
He's misleading children.
Yeah, maybe not. All right, this week's podcast poll of the week was... What's the deal with Rian Johnson's Star Wars trilogy? We had... It's the three untitled Star Wars films to be announced. He's working with the Game of Thrones guys. Other comment below got 7%. There were most of those were people that said things like Rian Johnson is the devil.
And worse.
That's worse.
We didn't have a lot of that. Let's see. 27%. You had two that tied. It's the three untitled films where he's working with the Game of Thrones guys.
Have we ever had a tie?
I think we have with that. And then 39% won it pretty handily were that the Rian Johnson trilogy is yet to be announced.
And that was true.
Yeah. So,
good job.
Bob Iger announced this week that the 2022 movie is is going to be done by Benioff and Weiss.
Wait, didn't he say that
No, he did not say that all three of them were. That is a mistake. That is not true. It's being reported falsely. What Bob Iger said, almost by, I'm going to paraphrase, but it's like exactly the what he tried to get across, because I don't remember the exact words, so I can't say, and I quote, the Benioff and Weiss film will be the 2022 film. Mm-hmm. The 2022 will be done by Benioff and Weiss. Are you okay there, baby?
Yeah, I just couldn't move. I couldn't breathe.
Okay. Benioff and Weiss film will be the 2022 film. And that's all I'm going to say about it. And that's, he has not said it was the 2024 or 2026. And that's literally what he said. So
do you think they alternate?
I don't know. We'll have to think about that maybe a little bit later. We can talk about that. Why don't you go, BB Nate, read your quote, your tweet by, who is this by?
Darren Phillipson, and his Twitter handle is at Dazman 007.
The 007, baby.
Woo! Dazman 007.
Yeah. I've never seen one of those movies.
Oh, it's, you know,
they're all that good.
They're okay. Some of them are good, better than others. Anyway. Okay.
He said, at CinemaCon, which that sounds like the perfect con for me, he announced he was going back to the galaxy far, far away, and it's going to be his 100% focus. This is his trilogy.
So that person, so Darren believed that the 2022, 2024, 2026 were going to be his trilogy. He was wrong on that. We don't know what the 24 and 26 movies will be, but the 2022 is definitely not his. But he did at CinemaCon state that once the Knives Out film was completely dealt with and everything was finished on that, that he and Ram Bergman were going to be getting focusing on his trilogy 100%. So for all of you that are going around saying on social media and other podcasts and YouTube channels that Ryan Johnson's trilogy is dead now and it's been confirmed by Bob Iger, you're wrong with that. So anyway, so that's that one. Let's go to the next one here.
Yeah, so this is from Jason, Wearer of Chains.
Ooh, that's a good one.
And his name is Cool Young Luck.
I think that's Luke.
It's like, Cool. Is it Luke?
Yeah, I think it is.
It's Cool with a K. Young.
Like Carl Jung.
Right.
Actually, it's not because Carl Jung is the way
J-U-N-G. Right. Y-U-N-G yeah. And then L-U-C. So Cool with a K, Y-U-N-G-L-U-C.
All right, anyway. That's great.
Great. I think their films are on the same timeline, but the duo's film will come first. Ryan's will fill in the 2024 and 2026 later dates, or his first one might just be one of those. Bottom line, I doubt they'll be in pre-production slash production that long.
Yeah, so it's interesting. Yeah, exactly. Maybe Bob Iger's going around as
Jason Wearer of Chains.
As Jason Wearer of Chains. I don't know because he got the 2022 thing right. He's predicting 2024, 2026, or just 2024 will be Ryan's, but he doesn't think they'll be in production long. Well, guys, it's only 2019. If he just starts working on this by the end of this year, and it's a 2024 film, that's in production for 5 years. That's a long time for a movie.
Longer than Endgame was in production.
Yeah, well, but Endgame, they kind of knew where they were going with it. And then the last one we're going to read is from Paul at PaulFS83. He says, it's going to take some time. RJ, Ryan Johnson, said himself that he's a lazy writer, which is why he wrote TLG before TFA was finished. So I had never heard that Ryan had said that, but his thought process Paul's here, is that Ryan takes his time to write. And I think that actually may be a clue as to why this film has not been announced on the schedule yet. Because maybe Ryan hasn't written enough of it for them to feel it's ready to go ahead and put it out there.
That makes sense.
I still wonder if you're going to see a 2023, 2025, 2027 series announced, and that will be Ryan's movies. And we will get one movie a year like they have said that they want to do. So, I guess that's it for hot takes. See, I don't know why I said that last segment was hot takes. It's not. It was the podcast poll of the week. Hot takes. We have to have our buddy JG Carse on for hot takes. How's it going, JG?
Oh, it's going quite well, gentlemen. Very well.
Good. You feeling better than you were a week ago? We were sort of bummed you couldn't be on the show.
Oh, 100%. I can actually see now, which is way better than last time.
All right. Well, good. Okay. All right. Well, we're going to turn it over to you. Take it from here.
All right. The most recent issue of Dr. Aphra introduces yet another super weapon into the Star Wars universe, yet we haven't seen her hop off the pages onto our screens. With the deserving success of Dooku Jedi Lost, could it be the door to future content to fill in the gaps of canon? And could we be getting more Leia in The Rise of Skywalker than we expect? It's time for hot takes.
This is where the fun begins.
Well, you want the bad news or the really bad news?
Impressive. Every word in that sentence was wrong.
All right, Dr. Aphra introduces a new super weapon. And will she ever be introduced to the visual media? Jordan Pate of Star Wars Newsnet wrote, on their way out, Aphra sees another artifact that she's heard about before. The weapon of the Jedi Renegade. I'm going to try to pronounce this, but it's Star Wars. Uh-oh. We're going to go with that.
Do it again.
There
we go. Okay.
The apostate, known as Farkiller. The weapon is basically a sniper rifle that uses lightsaber technology, a weapon that both the Rebels and the Empire would no doubt like to get their hands on. When Aphra sees the weapon on a pedestal, there's no question. What she's come after is no longer what she needs. She's now after this. Now, my question for you, gentlemen, and I'm not sure if you guys have read this, is what do you think of this weapon? Like, we constantly see, you know, the Death Star, Starkiller base, and now we have a new, in my opinion, this is a super weapon in its own way. And so I'm curious to see your take on that. But also, Dr. Aphra is starting to become a character that is almost known by, I wouldn't say every Star Wars person out there, but it's becoming more of a common name. Do you think we'll ever see her in visual media, whether it be movie or TV?
Do I think? Yes, I do. With everything that they're doing with Vader, especially Vader Immortal, that has to do with the old Darth Vader. Not the old Darth Vader series, but the Darth Vader series around 2014,
2015. Okay, the first comic kind of series. Yeah.
Dr. Aphra was with Darth Vader, and Vader Immortal is now starting to come out with they confirmed that there's only going to be 3 episodes.
I thought it was 4.
But, no. So, I think she's going to show up in that. I hope that she gets into the big screen, the movies, because she's an interesting character. Of course, I read the first issue, and I'm like, right off the bat, I'm like, this is just the Indiana Jones.
It's Indiana it really Jones and Star Wars.
Star Wars.
Yeah. She just did it. And talking about the super weapon, when it shoots Kyber...
So you're familiar with what's going on with this? Are you aware of this?
No, but I didn't notice this, but also there's another super weapon, the Kyber Saber. That's not fully in canon yet, but we are pretty sure it's
coming in Vader Immortal.
And also, it was looked like it was at the end of Secrets of the Empire. That's what it looked like, and that is definitely a super weapon because one slice can cut a planet in half.
Well, the Lego version,
the Freemaker's Adventure version,
lore of it from there is what it says. Mm-hmm. So,
you think it's a super weapon, and you think that Dr. Aphra's coming. Mm. What about you, Samuel?
I think we will see Dr. Aphra. I don't think we'll see her on, like, big screen, like, box office. But I think she'll get a movie or something in Disney Plus or a TV show. I'd love to have a TV show of her. That would be a lot of fun.
Kind of like the young Indiana Jones.
Yeah, sort of. Yeah, it's something like that. Just because most of her stories are in shorter stories, like comics, so they'd fit for it to go into a TV show. As for the Lightsaber Sniper Rifle, I mean, it's basically just like a mini Death Star, because that's the Death Star.
Yeah, it's using the same technology.
Right. I like the idea. It's funny because when I was at the Mando Mercs thing, I was talking with the head guy, and you know, he's talking about how, like, some people, like, come up with these crazy long lore for their characters, right? And he's like, oh, I come from this planet, and this gun, you know, shoots lightsabers or stuff, you know, and then this happened. So I thought that was funny that you mentioned that, but I like the idea. It's cool. So it shoots just like bolts, right? Like bolts that are made, that are basically what a lightsaber's blade would be made out of. Like,
JG, do you know more about it?
Actually, we don't, because the weapon was just introduced. She goes there for a whole different reason, looking for a cape. And so she just stumbles upon this. And this was the first issue of the new arc. So it just was just introduced. It's super powerful, and we have yet to find out what it's fully capable of, and I do think we will.
So you think in future issues we will see this thing in action?
Oh, definitely. I think there's no reason why. Like, she obviously, it's in her possession now, and it's definitely setting up for it to be somehow in play for some reason.
Okay. Interesting.
I really got to get her back into reading.
Yeah, I'm sitting here and I'm hearing this, and I'm thinking about all the people that were cosplaying as Dr. Aphra at Star Wars Celebration and how popular this character is. And it's just one of those things where it's just not, we've not taken the time to read that series. And so I'm really interested in doing that. And getting started in it. As far as Dr. Aphra coming in some type of a live action format, I don't think they give her own series. You know, some of you guys were suggesting, like, I think Sam, you were suggesting like her own show or something on Disney Plus, and I don't think we see her do that. I don't think we get her in the big screen before we get Ahsoka. That would be, I think people would be pretty frustrated with that if you brought in Dr. Aphra on the big screen or in a Disney Plus series before that. As far as bringing her in for her own thing, I could see her showing up. We don't know what her storyline is going to be post the Galactic Civil War. This is all taking place before that, right? Or during it, right?
I believe so, yeah.
Yeah, so it's all place taking place like alongside that, because you've got Luke in it, you've got Han and Leia and some other characters. And so we don't know how where her story ends up, but if she's still alive during the Mandalorian era, we could see her in some scenes, maybe in season two at some point on that, or we could see her pre-Galactic Civil War in Cassian as a little cameo type situation. As far as the gun, it sounds amazing. I'm wondering if Galen Erso may had heard about this weapon as part of what he was trying to do with the Death Star stuff. So, what were you going to say, Sam?
I was going to say, you know, how you were talking about how we just haven't taken the time to read it. I mean, that was the same with the Vader series, and we ended up absolutely the Vader Dark Lord of the Sith series. And we read it and we absolutely loved it. It's probably our favorite comic series ever. So I imagine, or I'm hoping that that'll be the case with Dr. Aphra.
Yeah, I think we're going to enjoy it a lot. All right.
All right. So could we be getting some new flashback of Leia content in The Rise of Skywalker? I'm going to put this out there for the people who get super like weird about spoilers. I don't believe this is happening, so that's why I'm bringing it up in this conversation.
All right, I'm going to spoiler alert it.
But I think it does bring up some interesting conversations. So Kevin Berwick of MovieWeb.com said, with that being said, the latest, he says, leak, again, I don't think this is happening, but in case it does, suggests that Carrie Fisher's daughter, Billie Lourd, has a shot flashback scene for The Rise of Skywalker as Princess Leia, which takes place during Return of the Jedi. It's believed the scene will include Luke Skywalker and Leia, though it isn't clear if Mark Hamill will be playing himself with de-aging technology or not. The scene in question reportedly, quote, plays with our perspective, quote, on the latest trilogy, helping to explain some lingering questions. And my questions for you guys today is, do you think we need to have some scene that takes us back to the original trilogy with Leia? Or do you think this is just unnecessary?
I feel like the only reason to be put in there, and this is why I feel like it's not necessarily a good idea, is to help explain the Carrie Poppins moment in Last Jedi. Because that's one of the main gripes about that movie, is why can Leia suddenly fly through space, you know? And in Return of the Jedi, he's talking to Leia about how you have that power in you as well.
But we don't know the middle story about that.
Right, so that could be the only reason that I can think of that they would flash back all the way to Return of the Jedi, is to clear that up.
I think that most definitely, or I think we're going to see more Leia and... especially a flashback.
Well, yeah, like a flashback. I mean, we know we're going to get Leia, but right. A flashback
to
sort of Return of the Jedi era or post-Return of the Jedi?
I think that we're going to see maybe to keep it easier without doing de-aging technology on anybody, maybe the scene of Leia talking to Luke about being his sister and that whole scene.
Oh, you just think like a flashback type situation?
Cut in the footage.
From Return of the Jedi, that sequence, like a flashback or memory?
Yes, I think that's what they're going to do just to keep it, because I'm pretty sure that Leia wouldn't have filmed Carrie Fisher.
Yeah, because I thought that they said that they weren't going to use CGI or have anyone else portray Leia.
I'm going to go ahead and credit right now Jason Ward from MakingStarWars.net, who has further explored this and through his sources. And so we're going to be really, really careful right here. And I know we played a spoiler alert a minute ago, but when we started this, but this one is like a genuine spoiler alert. So hold on just one second. Yeah, so MakingStarWars.net, Jason Ward reported this week that Billie Lourd has been seen on set at some point, and that his understanding of this sequence is that it will be a CGI young de-aged version of Leia, with Billie Lourd being the person standing in for her, with a conversation between young Luke, which they aren't saying who that might be or how that's going to work.
Sebastian Stan. Just kidding.
No, I think, remember right after they started filming Rise of Skywalker, all these pictures came out of Mark Hamill without his beard, and everybody flipped out about that. I'm wondering if that was why he didn't have his beard, de-aged because they were filming that portion and de-aged him, mm-hmm. like they did Michael Douglas and Samuel L. Jackson. That could, the technology has gotten there in the Marvel Cinematic Universe to pull this off. The story that Jason has stated, and I'll try to keep this as spoiler light as possible without giving plot, is that what you are touching on, Samuel, is exactly what they're trying to do. They're trying to have a conversation about the Force and this deal. And from what his sources have said, is it will actually change the way you view some of the original trilogy and the way things go forward.
That's quite a claim right there.
And he's got sources. He was very careful on it on the report to state that it's only been one source that told him this. He hasn't had it confirmed by others, but this source has gotten lots of things right about the rise of Skywalker. So
follow-up question. Do you think that the fans would be upset about this? Because I feel like it can be very controversial. Well, everything in Star Wars is very controversial. But, I mean, I feel like this specifically could be very controversial.
Yeah, no, I do think it could be controversial. To go back to what one of you mentioned, that they had said they weren't going to do CGI Leia. What they had specifically stated, JJ is, and Kathleen Kennedy has said, they will not have a general Leia, CGI general Leia. Mm. So they're trying to, that type of thing. Billy Lord has been really, really instrumental in all the Leia stuff that's been going on in this film. I have a feeling that there's a lot of smoke around this. We'll see if there's some fire.
Do you think that it can lighten the fan? You good?
Yeah, I'm good.
The what?
It can lighten the fan response. It can kind of cool things down, with it being the fact that it is Carrie Fisher's daughter playing the character.
I hope that people will respect the idea.
Right.
So if they explain the Carrie Poppins, people are saying that J.J. Abrams is going to retcon Last Jedi. I don't think he's going to do that. I think he's going to explain it to make people... Because I think that J.J. Abrams agrees that it is a fantastic, amazing movie.
Yeah, I mean, he was working with Ryan Johnson with it.
I think he just wants people to find out that it is that, so that's he's going to explain it.
Okay.
All right. Wow, I learned a lot from that. Wow. All right, so to end it all off, and I think it's quite appropriate since you guys will be talking about this in your main show, to end it with a little Dooku Jedi Lost stuff. So with the huge success of Dooku Jedi Lost, could this open up the saga even more? James Whitbrook of Gizmodo.com agrees. Yes, Jedi Lost finally tells us the full story of Dooku's time in Jedi Order. But most importantly beyond that, it introduces us to a valuable time frame well before the events of his cinematic debut in Attack of the Clones, or even before the events of Phantom Menace, a time frame where the cracks in both the Jedi Order and Galactic Republic were beginning to truly open up, exposing a stagnant core in the moral center of the galaxy. So now, obviously, you guys are going to talk about this way more, and I can't wait for that conversation. But do you guys think and agree with James that this is going to open up to way more possibilities because of the fact that it's a little bit more than a book, a little bit less than a TV show, but this could now open up to so many new stories that could be told in between the movies we have yet to explore? And if so, which time periods do you want explored more?
I really like the idea of this book. I really enjoyed it. I enjoyed the full cast.
Which we'll talk about the book and stuff. But
I really want to see more of the period between episode 3 and episode 4.
So you don't think that this is... He's thinking... pre-Phantom Menace is what JG's asking.
I really think, in general,
in between whatever. Like, what do you, as personal for you guys, where do you guys want to explore?
That's cool.
I think I would want to explore that area more because there's a lot.
Early after 3, because we've explored that through Rebels, towards the end of that after period. 3
and to Rebels. Vader's explored early after 3.
Sure.
But like from... say how the Rebels become to be the Rebels and from Mon Mothma's perspective and everything like that. And I would also like to see, because they didn't really wrap up this book much. They kind of left it open for people to...
We'll talk about that in the book sequence next. But okay, so Samuel, what do you think?
No, I would love to see more content before Phantom Menace. I know everyone does. Everyone wants Old Republic. But I just loved the fact that it was set before that time because you got to see stuff. And we'll talk about this in the next segment. But I would like to see... Well, no, this might be a spoiler, actually. So, no, I won't say it. I would like to see more pre-Phantom Menace content.
Okay. I'll answer this by sharing, I don't know, something that I haven't shared a lot. But I don't think I've ever shared it on the podcast. But I've done some writing in the past. I've never done a lot of fiction, but I've had some ideas for fiction in the past. And I enjoy doing that. I actually was really intrigued by... Sifo Dyas's storyline, and how we understood definitely. More about him. I think that we could. I've thought about like fan fiction about Sifo Dyas and building some stuff on that, and Lean Castana and their storylines, because there's some crazy stuff that those two encountered that we haven't heard about. So even if they decided to do something about that, go for it.
Do you think do a buddy cop book?
No. I just because in the storyline we'll talk about it in the next segment, but Sifo Dyas is dealing with some real significant almost like borderline mental illness as a result of his force powers. And so you've got, and then she, Lean Castana, is going after Sith relics like crazy, which a good Jedi shouldn't do. I bet you there's some fun stories. Yeah. I would love to see that explored more. So yeah.
I don't remember much. I know they explored Sifo Dyas's story a little bit in Clone Wars towards the end, but I don't remember. He was sort of crazed at the end though.
Yeah, oh yeah, he's like he's fully given in on onto it. So
okay.
Yeah, there's a lot there. I think that they're going to do we're gonna start seeing a lot more.
Do you think we get like a Dooku Jedi Lost too?
Well, we'll have to talk about that in the next segment. So all right. Well, that's it for Hot Takes, JG. We appreciate it. So tell us a little bit about what are you gonna be talking about on Blue Saber this week.
Yeah, so finally, I know it's a little month late, but it's better late than never. We'll be doing a fun celebration recap and talking about a little bit of the future of Star Wars and what's to come. And I will have a special guest who's kind of known on Twitter, so I'll be quite excited for that.
Oh, nice. I'm very excited about that. Teased it just a little bit. When is the show going to hit our podcatchers and everything?
Yes, it's going to be hitting the airwaves on Monday, given enough time to make a nice edited show for you all.
Nice. Well, I'm definitely excited to hear that. Maybe you'll have to tell me behind the scenes who your little fun guest is. I'm excited about that. Thank you so much, JG. We'll talk to you again next week.
All right. Have a good day, guys.
You too. Well, last week when we finished listening to the audio drama Dooku Jedi Lost by Cavan Scott, and there are some interesting revelations and hints about recent Star Wars themes in it. And tonight we'll give our spoiler-filled review and thoughts on what we hope is the first of many books in this new format.
Rebellions are built on hope.
If you live long enough, you see the same eyes in different people.
I find your lack of faith disturbing.
All right. I will not let our listeners in on what was going on while the...
I can.
No, let's not. All right. So let's start with just initial reaction about the story and about the
everything. Spoiler
format.
Not spoiler?
No, it's not spoiler related. Okay. Let's just go. What was your initial reaction
Amazing
about it?
Amazing book. I was a little bit on edge of the audio drama, and since there was going to be a full cast, I was a little bit wondering what they were going to choose for the voices. But I really liked what he did with the book. I enjoyed it. I really kept me onto the storyline. It was very fun how they did the different timelines in it, and that's probably all I'm going to say.
Okay.
No, I loved the format. It was really fun. It was interesting to see how he wrote it, because you could tell it was different from an audio book in the way he wrote it. Like, really wasn't any narration. Like, third person... out-of-body narration. It was always...
No, and without spoiling it, it doesn't really spoil it right now. We're going to get into spoilers in a minute, but the narrator of this is Asajj.
Right.
Ventress. And so even though there is sort of a narrator involved, she's a character.
It's from someone's point of
and
view.
And she's living it out... Mm-hmm. She's living out discovering this information as the narrator, but she's not, like, narrating it. Does that make sense?
No, she's, like... It's more her... observations of what's happening.
And it's not like
her conclusions.
Yeah, and we'll talk about how that worked. There was a pretty interesting sort of plot device or something that they did in there that allowed them to keep that part going. Yeah. So we'll talk about that. But
yeah, I mean, I loved it. I really, really want more in this format. I want more from Cavan Scott. He did really well.
Yeah,
and since this is his wheelhouse.
Yeah, having done Doctor Who and some other audio dramas.
I would love for him to do more audio dramas, maybe even Dooku.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, so for those of you that are listening, that was 2 minutes or so of our non-spoiler-filled review. So now we're going to go spoiler-filled. All right. Let's talk Asajj for just like one small segment, because her character was not... It was central to the whole storyline, but this book was not about Asajj.
No, not at all.
It was definitely about Dooku. It was rightfully titled Dooku Jedi Lost.
And he did good of keeping her in the story, but not making it about her.
Yeah, and so explain, you know, you picked up on what I was talking about. Explain about that plot device that they used in there in order to allow us to have Asajj function like a narrator without her narrating, like giving us, you know, Dooku walked across the room and that kind of stuff.
And Dooku said...
Yeah, that kind of stuff.
I'm pretty sure I caught on what you're talking about. It was her former Jedi Master, Kai Narek. Now, he was killed on Ratatak, right?
Which is a great name, by the way.
I know, right? Ratatak. Every time I heard it...
Ratatak.
Ratatak. Anyway...
makes me think of giant rodents attacking.
I know.
Impressive. Everyone in that sense was wrong.
Well, you never picked up on that? Seriously, that's the first thing I thought of. All
right.
Anyway,
this is the only reason you remember it.
Right. He was killed on Ratatak. I'm trying to remember that part of the story, because that was explored in Clone Wars. And anyway, she was a slave. Kai Narek found her, rescued her, trained her for a while. Never took her to the Jedi Temple. They stayed on Ratatak. He got killed. You're going to laugh every time I say Ratatak now, isn't it? He got killed, and then she was found by Dooku, right? Or she was taken by a guy, became a gladiator, then Dooku found her.
Yeah, so explain the plot device before you go into that part of it.
Right. Basically, he became this Force ghost, but it wasn't a ghost. It was just a voice in Asajj's head, constantly talking to her, pointing things out.
So is he with her even in the Clone Wars? Is he talking to her throughout everything that she does?
I don't think so, because at the end, the decision she made... Well, I don't know why.
Yeah, we'll talk about it. I think you're right. I think that your question is valid, and I think your answer, Samuel, without us going into it yet, let's go to that towards the end, is actually the answer to that. But it's interesting, because we don't know if he's a Force ghost or Force voice. Or it's just her insanity as she goes to the dark side.
Really,
and they never elaborated on that. But the reality is, she, throughout the entire book, Asajj is having a conversation with Kai Narek throughout the entire book in her head with it. And it puts her in really weird spots a couple of times where she's having conversations with him and other people are hearing it.
Right.
Like, looking like... sort of like schizophrenia, I'm sure. It was really bizarre with it, but it allowed her to tell us things that were going on, and for him, as this voice, to ask questions about things that were going on that moved the story and filled in details.
Kai Narek really was the listener's voice in the book. He asked the questions we weren't able to ask, point the things out that we weren't able to point out, explain, that guy's not good to Ahsoka. He was really,
Asajj, not Ahsoka. This is the
Asajj. Yeah, he was our voice.
And by the way, Ahsoka is not in this book.
Yeah, there we go. Spoiler alert, right?
No Ahsoka.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
So cool. So what did you think about the whole Kai Narek Asajj venture?
I really enjoyed the kind of conversations between them. They were always kind of like an old couple, just bickering at each other the whole time. It was, like you said, it was kind of the listener's voice, but it was also kind of the narrator's voice as well.
Yeah, they both functioned
kind of
as
not
narrators.
A character really, but still there.
I mean, and going back to the banter, I mean, it was fun. You know, he was like, "Oh, I'm sorry. I thought, you know," Asajj was like, "Get out of my head. You're just a voice." And then she'd ask him a question, and he's like, "Oh, I'm sorry. I thought I was just a voice."
Yeah,
you know, awesome. It was a lot of fun.
This is madness.
Yeah. So, one thing that happened early on in this book, which I knew about before we started listening, and I think I mentioned it to you guys, because it's not major, it's not like a big spoiler.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Is they canonized something from the 2003 Tartakovsky Clone Wars. Mm-hmm. Explain what that was, Samuel.
Yeah, so it wasn't exactly how it happened in Tartakovsky's Clone Wars, but for the most part, it is the same. In Tartakovsky's Clone Wars, Dooku goes to this gladiator arena on some planet, and he's watching all these gladiators fight in this pit, and then you see Asajj. And she's going through, and she wipes them all out in quick succession. Then Dooku jumps down, they fight, she gets incapacitated, and gets taken back to his place, or whatever.
Palace, whatever.
It's not the same as in Clone Wars, or... You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Newer Clone Wars. In this, he... Oh, jeez. I'm trying to remember exactly how it happened. Why don't you explain it? I think...
It was essentially that she's battling in there, and that she's been doing that, and he selects her. And
he kills her captor.
Yeah.
And that actually really upset her, because she had this burning hatred for her captor.
And she wanted to kill him.
And when she saw that he was killed, she was... livid at Dooku, and that kind of set the tone for their relationship.
This master, not apprentice. I don't see Asajj ever as an apprentice, and I think that that's an important element, because Dooku at this point is Sith. Mm-hmm. He is the apprentice,
right?
Sith. He's not her master in that same Sith type master apprentice thing. She's his slave.
Assassin.
His assassin, but also his slave in this. And he treats her as such. It's an ugly, really, really toxic.
And at the end, you really do see Stockholm Syndrome.
Oh, without a doubt.
And it's pretty sad. Because you know her backstory and how horrible and tragic it's been. And traumatizing.
Yeah.
And then that she's... roped into this.
Yeah. Now, the challenge is we spent 10 minutes talking about something that we said isn't a major part of the book, and that's Asajj. So let's talk about the book, alright? There's these different scenes. So basically the entire book, the audio novel is what we're going to call it, because it's not a book. There's no print version of it, and they've said at this point that there's no plans for a print version, which...
why would you?
Yeah, no, I think it's a great... You know, it would be interesting to see, but... They basically, you get the entire story of Dooku as an initiate into the Jedi Order as a child, not even really a Padawan yet. He's still called an initiate, all the way through him leaving the Jedi Order. Mm-hmm. You get his entire Jedi arc with it. So let's talk about it in those segments as we go forward with it. Let's talk about Dooku as an initiate. We see him, first of all, they're brought to this big intergalactic festival on the planet Serreno, which is where Dooku's from. But he doesn't know his family. He's never met his family. Doesn't remember his family. But he's on Serreno. Mm-hmm. And he doesn't know anything more than that's the planet that he came from.
Right.
But we're introduced to who becomes his best friend. Who is his best friend at this point.
Sifo Dyas.
Yeah. So we see Sifo Dyas and Dooku as children on this. Talk a little bit about their relationship before we kind of... I mean, don't go into, like, the details of the future, but just talk about their relationship just a little bit.
Sifo Dyas was more of the troublemaker, and Dooku was a rule follower, which is kind of...
Not surprising.
Surprising at all. And he kind of was his friend. He enjoyed being around him. He had fun with him. But he didn't like the troublemaker inside of him.
Mm-hmm. And they get into a lot of trouble together, though, because Dooku is always sort of following, you know, he's resisting the lead of Sifo Dyas to doing things that he shouldn't do, but then he goes along with it, which is an interesting storyline. I mean, think the pattern of behavior, because he's going to become a Sith later, and he's going to end up following somebody else's lead then,
too. Is that partly Sifo Dyas' fault?
I fully believe that Dooku's path towards the Jedi, or towards the Sith, was paved by Sifo Dyas, which we'll talk about in a little bit. So they've got this friend relationship. Mm-hmm. We're on Serreno. They wander off, and he sees this girl. Who's the girl?
What's her name?
Jenza. Yeah, so explain who she is and what happens with that real quick.
She's just the Count of Serreno's daughter, brother of Ramil.
That one thing that's important to talk about is the the political system on Serreno. There are multiple houses which reside over certain areas in Serreno, guided by one royal family. And then there's the Count of Serreno. There's the House of Serreno, which abides.
Did we suddenly start talking Game of Thrones with the House of Serreno and the House? I'm sorry.
Should we get a Game of Thrones series of Serreno?
Wow, that's an interesting idea. Maybe that's a fanfic.
Early. Could write. Anyway. And the House of Serreno resides over all of Serreno, hence the name. And Jenza is the daughter
of the Count of Serreno.
Right.
And the brother of. And she's a sister of Ramil.
Right. But that's not the big revelation.
No.
The revelation is Dooku sees Jenza. Jenza meets Dooku, and they feel this connection. And before long, we find out.
Their brother and sister.
That they're brother and sister. That makes Dooku the son of the Count of Serreno with it. Now, we don't really find that out at the beginning or in their relationship. We didn't find that out at the very end with this deal that's in this. I cannot remember. I was driving up to Breckenridge when I was listening to this. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to remember what this temple of some sort that there is.
It was the House of Serreno.
It was their courthouse, pretty much, or their Senate.
And they found these carvings on these walls, kind of like the scene in Tarkovsky's Clone Wars about the whole when Anakin is.
Okay, yeah, so the Anakin scene in there.
It was a statue, I thought.
No. Well, no, they see a statue. No, they do.
They do see
The statue of this dragon. Oh, it's called the Tirataka.
Tirataka.
Okay.
It kind of sounds like terracotta.
Yeah. So, anyway, it's like this. It's this beast that is tied to, we learn, Sith lore. On the planet of Serreno,
it was called the dragon. Was called the dragon that holds the world together, or something like that. And it was this massive beast, supposedly of legend.
And so we find out that and the other thing that ties into this is how the Serrenos became the House of Serreno became the ruling group. Mm-hmm. The Sith ruled the planet of Serreno, and for I guess centuries during the reign of the Sith. And they had apparently had this dragon was symbolizing that, according to what we hear at the beginning of this, is like symbolizing that. And the House of Serreno overthrew the Sith on that planet, and that's how they became the ruling house of this. So Dooku becomes, as a child, he's like 10 or 11 maybe at most, he becomes fascinated with the Tirataka dragon, and he wants to touch it.
Well, he's like in this trance.
Yeah.
Like he's drawn to it and he can't fight it.
Right. And so Jenza keeps telling him not to touch it, it's bad luck to touch it.
Yeah.
He touches it and the entire earthquake starts to go. A groundquake. Yeah, earthquake, same difference, right?
No, it's not Earth.
Well, it's the same thing. It's a groundquake because they're on a different planet, right? Because it would be an earthquake.
It would be weird to be calling it an earthquake.
I get it, all right? So anyway.
Come on, Dad.
I got it, all right?
Every word in that sense was wrong.
So anyway, thank you, Luke. What was I talking about?
He touches it.
The groundquake happens. Jenza is almost killed. Dooku's almost killed. They end up, the Jedi come to rescue it. And it's in that process that the Count of Serreno, and I can't remember his name, and it isn't really all that relevant to our conversation.
I think it's just Count of Serreno.
No, it is. He's got a name. The Count of Serreno comes, and in that process, he sees Yoda, he sees Dooku, and he reveals that he's Dooku's father, and that is
when... That pretty much sets everything
off. That's a pretty amazing scenario there. But what's interesting that I think the biggest thing that we've take from that whole segment is, I mean, you knew he was related to the Count of Serreno. You knew that kind of stuff was going to happen in this book. But the Sith element with Serreno is a major, for me, is like a big time revelation. That's a part of that. And that plays itself out through the rest of the book. Mm-hmm. And then how Dooku came to be a part of the Jedi, or to be taken to the Jedi. Do you remember how that all worked?
It was just a seeker found him, right?
Yeah.
Right, but it's because the Count of Serreno, his father, found out that Dooku had suspected he had Force powers, and he basically hated him because of the whole Sith backstory. So he contacted the Jedi Order and said, "The baby's laying outside the gates of the city. If you want him, go get him."
Yeah, like in the middle of the night, exposed to.
He could have been killed, all this other stuff. So that's how Dooku's story starts. What do you guys think about that? Is he almost destined? Born on a planet that was used to be ruled by the Sith, rejected by his family. Good Lord, that's almost
like... We're talking about Star Wars here. Everything's tied together and always connected. So I think it is
that was not a coincidence.
Absolutely. And then you've got this, it sort of moves forward in the storyline. You know, I'm trying to avoid going through the entire story. If you want to listen to the book, just go listen to the book.
Right, we're going to be here for what, 6 hours?
Yeah, exactly. But then we've got the, you know, this moment where Sifo Dyas, we talked about this earlier, Sifo Dyas is always leading him down this path that he resists but ends up going along anyway with.
Right.
And they end up finding and looking for the Sith archives.
Bogan collection.
The Bogan collection on, in the Jedi Temple. Mm-hmm. With Padawan they start seeking out these things that this Padawan Teradine, that was a Padawan that, or Jedi that left the Order, a Padawan that left the Order, and they aren't sure it's like a legend, and if it's real or not. He finds his diary. They find the Sith archives.
It's sort of like a a myth within the temple.
Yeah, or a folk tale or a legend or something like that with it. But it's important because they go into the Sith archives. They break in. They find it. They find the Sith archives. And Dooku, again, has a vision now of their Tirataka, the Tirataka dragon.
One little just Easter egg that they threw in there, which I thought was interesting, is, you know, they're like, they're talking about this scroll and this lightsaber or whatever, and, you know, at one point they're like, wait a minute, what's that weird mask? And Nathan and I, as soon as we heard that, we just kind of, I turn around in the front seat and look at him, and we both know that that's Lord Momon's mask that we see in the Vader comics, which we thought was a cool little Easter egg.
It's nuts. So this Tirataka dragon and the Sith backstory to the Serreno and all that, that's playing into this even now. In the story, it's shortly after this that we're fully introduced to a Jedi master named Leen Castana. Yeah. And Leen Castana, that's an interesting character. I alluded to her in the last segment. We were talking about the possibility of, at the beginning of this segment, I guess, the fan. When was it? The fanfic stuff that I was talking about. Leen Castana. Is a Jedi master that sort of bucks the trend against the Jedi Council
a lot,
and is totally fascinated with two things: prophecy and the Sith. Mm-hmm. And she's convinced that the Sith are going to come back, and that she needs to understand everything she can about the Sith so that they can know their enemy. And Dooku, at this point in the story, becomes obsessed with Master Castana. What did you think about Leen Castana, BB Nate?
I thought she was a really interesting character. I don't think we've ever seen her anywhere before or heard anything about her. But to be kind of a, not outlaw per se, but just a rebel, basically, just trying to...
A renegade, sort
an
of.
Outlier. She wants to understand more about her enemy, and kind of the Jedi Council finds that to be a little wrong and unethical.
It's an unhealthy obsession. Yes. There's knowing your enemy, and then there's an obsession.
Yeah, and she's... after this moment when they break into the Sith archives and they're being punished and all these things, she steers
Dooku,
Sifo Dyas, and Dooku down the path of continuing this obsession.
Yeah, she
with prophecy
a book
and something. With looking
she
for
gets
Sith
the pages
archives
of
and things
a book,
like that.
And it's insane.
Yeah, so that, you know, it's so much so that Dooku becomes obsessed with becoming her Padawan.
Yeah.
And then we move into that segment of it. So it's interesting because there's this moment where they're being selected and we know outside the story, having seen Attack of the Clones, knowing the backstory of Dooku, that Dooku was the Padawan of Master Yoda.
Right.
But in the story up to this point, he's really hoping and pursuing this idea of Master Castana taking him as her Padawan. Sifo Dyas is selected by Castana And that really upsets Dooku.
Yeah.
And then we find that Yoda has selected...
And then he's okay. Master Dooku. He's like, oh.
Well, and that goes back to this idea that Dooku thinks he's the best, so he should be with the best. So if I'm not going to be with Kastana, then of course Yoda, who's not been taken a Padawan in 100 years or something, mm-hmm. is now going to take me as his Padawan because I am the best. Right. Which is goes back to sort of that difference in who Dooku and Sifo Dyas is with this. So talk about that moment of initial training, BB Nate, with Yoda and how that... I thought that was really interesting
how he just kept meditating, kind of just, you know, sitting there.
So he would call Dooku to the garden.
Yeah, training.
We're going to start training today. And then...
Then he would meditate and just sit there.
And ignore Dooku.
And ignore Dooku. Just kind of block him out. And then, I think, like, 60 days in.
Yeah, it was like a couple of months.
Yeah,
it
was 20 days.
Might have been. I don't know.
It was a long time. It was a long time in. Dooku is done with it. And the tree that's been there for... Ever since the Jedi Temple was built, he tries to rip it out
because
of the ground.
It has such a connection with Yoda because Yoda loves it or something.
Yeah, and so he decides to try to pull it out, and he says that it's too strong and he cannot do it. And I was kind of thinking then, like, size matters not in that. And so Yoda finally then... Dooku looks up and Yoda's like, okay, you ready to begin your training?
Well, yeah, he basically sits down and gives up.
Right.
Because he can't do anything. And he's like, there's nothing that I can do. So he just sort of, he fails and then he sits down.
The greatest teacher failures.
Exactly. He surrenders and he just sits down on the ground next by Yoda. And Yoda just looks over and says, ready to begin your training, you are? You know, and they move forward with that. What did you think about that sequence?
Yeah, no, it was frustrating to listen to. I'm like, come on, Yoda, like, why the heck did you?
Pick oh, I knew from the anything? Beginning that that's what he was waiting.
Yeah,
for.
No, I figured that he was waiting for Dooku to join in or, you know, give in a way. I loved it. It's very Yoda-esque. So I like that.
Yeah. So later on in the during this training time. Kastana, Master Kastana, and Sifo Dyas have to go on a mission, and I don't remember why Dooku went with them as he's a Padawan for the Presagers of Hakotai, that planet, the Dark Side Acolytes near Serreno.
I don't remember.
They're going to Serreno or something like that. Oh, he was being... Yeah, I don't remember exactly the motivation why they did this, but Kastana takes both Sifo Dyas and Dooku on a mission, and while they're on the mission, they go to this planet called Hakotai.
Oh, he had to go to Serreno for his mother's funeral.
Oh, that's it. Yeah,
this is way late in the story.
Yeah, well, I'm scooping forward because honestly,
not much happens.
I mean, there's so many important parts in this book,
but we can't tell about the whole thing. I'm literally going to go through this section, and then we're going to like talk about the resolution because I think this is where things get.
This
is a big moment. So the Hakotai begin this strange ritual and are frankly looking to sacrifice Dooku.
I was like, for a conduit.
Yeah, they call him a conduit of the Force. Mm-hmm. And they're trying to access the dark side with this. And all these dark forces start coming out.
It was...
This vision happens with Dooku. And listening to it kind of felt like you were on a bit of an acid trip.
Yeah, it was weird. The dark side basically reveals itself to Dooku. He has these visions. He hears these voices from both the past, the present, and the future. He sees beyond the Clone Wars. He sees Order 66. He sees Darth Sidious. And the return of the Sith.
Yeah.
To this. And all this death and destruction that's coming this way. And then just before he wakes up, we hear on this, and again, this is an audio novel, so you're not reading it. You just hear this lightning, and what we find out is that Dooku uses force lightning to destroy his captors that are trying to sacrifice him while he's doing this. What was your thoughts on that?
It was crazy. I mean, I was kind of like excited because that's one of the things that Dooku's known for is force lightning. That's like his thing. So it was awesome to finally figure out, oh, that's how that happened, you know? But
that's the first time it happens. This isn't when he goes to the dark side.
No, I'm saying that's how... That right, yeah, you know what I meant. It was crazy. That was such a weird sequence.
It was a lot like, I'm pretty sure it was in the Mortis arc when Anakin keeps seeing the visions of the future.
Yes.
From the dark side.
Although his mind got wiped. Dooku's didn't.
No, Dooku experienced this. And that's what leads to sort of the... And again, I said this before. I do... I believe that Sifo Dyas and Kostana paved the road for Dooku to go to leave the Jedi Order and, become a Sith. I mean... And in their obsession with prophecy and their obsession with the dark side and the Sith, and trying to understand them, they pulled Dooku to a place that Dooku couldn't come out of.
Yeah.
And
he was obsessed with what he saw in the future.
Which is interesting because in Master and Apprentice, we learn that he's rejecting prophecy. At that point of his, he doesn't want to have anything to do with prophecy. He's telling Qui-Gon he shouldn't have anything to do with prophecy, and just ignore all that kind of stuff. And you know, his other apprentice, Rael Avaros, who's a major part. He's in this book and this audio novel. Which,
I just want to touch on Rael Avaros. He was such a. It was brilliant the way. It was brilliant the voice casting they chose, because Dooku is such a proper, put together character, so they chose a British voice. Well, I mean, obviously that was already, and we associate that voice with proper, polite, rule follower. And then his Padawan,
before Qui-Gon Jinn,
which we know is a rebel, not rule follower,
ladies' man kind of stuff,
right? They choose a southern accent, which we attribute with all those.
Yeah, it was good.
So it was. I just thought that was brilliant how they chose that voice.
Yes, it was good.
Anyway.
But yeah, so, you know, Rael Avaros is the one that really pushes Qui-Gon towards prophecy and the Chosen One stuff in Master and Apprentice, not Dooku. And so I feel like Dooku is, you know, what we learn is that Dooku is, he sees what happens with Sifo Dyas, who becomes, as I mentioned a little earlier in the conversation, Sifo Dyas starts having these visions and he can't control them. And these visions of destruction and things like that start happening. And that is what causes Sifo Dyas to sort of lose grasp of reality.
He really does start losing his mind.
To this extent. And we know he's seeing Order 66. He's seeing the clones. He's seeing all the Sith and all this as well. And he becomes obsessed with it. And so there's this moment, you know, that's what's going on there. But I thought it was a really interesting thing that we've talked about a little bit. And I actually reached out to Cavan Scott about it this morning. And asked him about, or mentioned something about this.
You're just now telling us?
Yeah, I was going to tell you at dinner. I decided to wait until the show, right? So there's this, Kostana, Master Kostana, has taught this ritual to Sifo Dyas in order to help Sifo Dyas deal with his visions and his prophecies and the dark side and things like that. And so she teaches it to Dooku, and it's this deal where he wraps his arm in this cloth
that has
writings on it, with it, and he pronounces this this mantra or this chant as he's doing it.
And this chant, if you listen to it, it's very like it's talking about the light is good in its own way, the dark is good as its own way.
Yeah, well, why don't I just read what the chant is?
Oh, okay, that works.
That'd be good, huh? Light, dark, and balance true. One is no greater than the others. Together they unite, restore, recenter, and renew. I walk into the light and acknowledge the dark and find balance within ourselves. Does this not feel like Last Jedi type stuff and Mortis type stuff?
Great Jedi type stuff.
I got a bad feeling about this.
Yeah. Now, so here's what I do. I reach out, and I knew I had heard, I'd read on Twitter, Cavan Scott mentioning this, that he actually took this from some witchcraft stuff that he had read about. I know, which was pretty intense. Exactly. And so I reached out to him, and I said, you know, I understand you found this from a different source, but it reminds me of what Orthodox, and you felt the same way. What Orthodox Jewish men do, they have these... this leather cord that they wrap all the way around their arm, and it's got the Shema, the Hebrew most important prayer, Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, Baruch Shem Kavod, Mechute Leolam Vaed. Hear, O Israel, Adonai is your God, Adonai alone, blessed is the name of his glorious kingdom now and forever. So they have that inscribed on this leather cloth, and they wrap it around their arm. So that felt like the cloth, right?
Right.
Then I remember in the daily Amidah prayer that the Hebrew Orthodox men pray, after they wrap this around their arm, there's a section that says, blessed are you, Adonai, our God, King of the universe, who forms light, creates darkness, makes peace, and creates all. So I thought, man, those two things tie into
similar.
This. So I said, hey, Cavan, you know, I know you found it from another source, but... And I explained those things on there. And he replied back within just a few minutes. And he said, I studied all that in university. So I think that some of that may have played into it as well.
Oh, that's cool. That's really cool.
It was pretty neat. But the whole point behind that ritual was it was a way to control the dark side.
Yeah.
Within Dooku. So, and that's like halfway through the book. There's so much more.
Because that's before he's old. That's he's not a Padawan at that point.
He's like 20.
He's a knight.
He is a knight. He's not a Padawan at that point. Yeah, you're right with that. So let's skip forward. So, you know, there's this... He goes later on in the story. He ends up having to go back to Serreno. His father has died. Jenza has called for his help, who he still has a relationship with that he's been keeping in secret. Ramil, his older brother, has now become the Count, and he is a bad dude. And Jenza asks for Dooku and asks for the Jedi and for the Senate. This is really important.
Yeah.
The Jedi and the Senate to send help because they're being attacked by the Abyssin and they're
and Ramil's doing nothing.
So
and Ramil's not doing anything to help them, and they need this whole.
So it wasn't it that they hired these mercenaries to protect them, and once the protection was done, those mercenaries decided, yeah, we'll just set this up as our base of operations.
Yeah, it's something essentially like that. And so the point is, the Senate fails to see any need because Count Ramil. Hasn't paid his taxes to the Senate. So they're like, you haven't paid your taxes, we're not helping you.
Yeah.
And the Jedi are like, Senate said no, we're not going to do anything about this. So Dooku, Lean Castana, Master Castana, and Sifo Dyas, they go.
Just the three of them.
Just the three of them to help. And all Sith breaks loose on that planet. Yeah, it does in a big, significant way. And we'll let you listen to the rest of the book if you have.
Yeah.
So, with that, so here's one thing I think is interesting. And I did reach out. I tweeted this, and actually, Cavan Scott retweeted it with just the word "nice" as the comment on this. I said. The reason that Master Jedi Dooku, Jedi Master Dooku forsook the Jedi way,
where does this King
James is the exact same reason that Luke it matches up with the third lesson that Luke was going to teach Rey that's in the Jedi novel, the Last Jedi novelization, and that is that the Jedi failed to take action when it was necessary. They always would wait till it was like in their best interest themselves before they took action. And Luke is teaching Rey in the Last Jedi, at least in the novelization, that is wrong.
And
the deleted scene is in there as well, and that is the reason. That Count Dooku left the Jedi Order. That's not why he became Sith. We don't have that story yet.
I want that story.
But that's why he leaves the Jedi Order. I tweeted that out. Cavan Scott retweeted it with the word "nice." So, like, I figured, like, I understood it. I'm hoping that I understood, Cavan. All right. So, I hope you listen to this or see this and do that. All right. Would you recommend Count Dooku Jedi Lost?
Yes.
I've already recommended it.
Yeah. Phenomenal. Check it out. We're going to go ahead and put up a link on our website on the podcast episode here where you can go in and just go ahead and download it, purchase it on Audible, purchase it on Amazon, wherever you want to purchase it, a digital version of it. You can purchase a hard copy version of it if you want as well. And if you purchase it through our page, honestly, it's going to help our show. We're going to get paid a little bit of an affiliate benefit because you did that. It won't change the price at all for you. So I guess that pretty much wraps up what was supposed to be a 25-minute conversation into 37 minutes.
There's still so much we could talk about.
It we was awesome. Talked about a six-hour book in 37 minutes. Yeah. That is impressive.
Yeah. We skimmed.
Yeah, absolutely. Check it out if you have. All right. Is there anything else you guys want to talk about?
Anything else?
So, the Star Wars Chicago 2019 celebration store is now online, but only for badge people for now, and a little bit later it's going to be released.
But we haven't got an email about that. How do we do this?
You have a link, and you gave your email about that you use for kind of like the read path.
Oh, so you just log in through it?
Yeah, you log in through it.
So they're basically just selling their excess, right?
Their excess stuff.
Now, if they did it this time, what they're setting us up for is that they plan on doing this in the future, which means we don't have to wait for hours in line at the Star Wars Celebration store, which I think is great.
I wish I could have gotten that holiday special lunchbox with Boba Fett on it.
Well, we'll see if
I'm going to take that to college. Right. I'm going to have a full-on tin lunchbox. I'm not even kidding.
All right, that's cool.
So there's a third live-action Star Wars television series coming to Disney+.
Yeah.
We still don't know anything about it.
Star Wars Newsnet's been reporting for about 3 months that the Kenobi TV series was in the works.
It really wants to be in Ahsoka.
That's not going to happen. It's going to be Kenobi.
Okay. Hoping that it's the Sherlock version. Like that Sherlock series.
Like six episodes or four episodes, and they're all 2 hours long.
Right.
The reality is... All the, Collider's reported this, Star Wars News has reported it, I believe in Making Star Wars has reported this, that they were ready to announce a Kenobi movie right after Solo. The plan was to announce it after Solo. That's why Ewan McGregor was at the red carpet premiere. That's why Ewan McGregor was at the premiere of Solo, a Star Wars story. But then with all of the craziness that happened with the box office take at that, they pulled it back.
Yeah.
They're redoing it. They probably had to come through a new contract negotiation, talk about it a little differently with Ewan McGregor, but it's coming. I believe it's Kenobi. I believe it's going to be better than what we would have gotten in a film. And that's all I have to say about that. All right. Speaking of Solo, hashtag Make Solo 2 Happen Day is coming on the 23rd. That's next Friday. That's next Thursday.
It's my birthday eve.
It's your birthday eve. Where we're going to celebrate all over social media. Star Wars News Net, Resistance Broadcast is putting this together. We're going to be a part of it. I know lots of other people that are going to be a part of it. We're going to be tweeting the hashtag Make Solo 2. That's with the number 2. Happen. All over social media on the 23rd. Celebrating Solo, a Star Wars story, so that it gets the word out. Maybe Disney, maybe Bob Iger, maybe Lucasfilm, Kathleen Kennedy will see this and realize there is a market for them to continue the story. Because we still don't know what happened with Kira. We don't know why Maul was in there. And we need to find out. So, that's that. All right. So, are you guys ready for this? This week's...
You took my... You emboldened and italicized and underlined.
I did. Thank you. This week's podcast poll of the week. Would you like to see a sequel to...
Yes.
Dooku Jedi Lost? We know Nathan.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes, no, or other comment below.
Okay, why would anybody say no if they listened to
it? No, I don't know. Maybe they didn't like it, you know? There was only one criticism, and it had nothing to do with the writing. It had to do with the production of it. In the last act, when they get back to Serreno, and things are going back and forth between the back timeline when all things are happening on Serreno and Asajj trying to explain it, it got muddy. Going back and forth. And the reason it got muddy is because Jenza is present in both of those. Starts telling the story.
Yeah,
it gets a little bit confusing at times. I actually had to rewind it a couple of times and listen to some of that because I was lost. So
Otherwise, it was really good.
Other than that. But again, that's production value. So, that, you know, that's our one criticism. Yeah. So, anyway, that's going to do it for this week's show. We want to thank all of our producers. You guys are amazing, supporting us on Patreon, making this show possible, helping us get... You chose this topic. Thank you. You chose our sticker of the month. Thank you. You support us financially. You give us feedback. We appreciate it very much. Our producers, Eric McGilvray, Ian Thompson, and Emily Hoffman. Thank you guys so much for being a part of the show. Senior producers, Kate Disney Lugers, Judith Jesse. Thanks, Mom. Roberto Moreno. And, of course, our executive producer and contributor to the show, J.G. Carse. If you want to become a part of the show, become a member of the sticker of the month, t-shirt of the month.
Maybe an executive producer if you want.
If you want to be at the level of executive producer, you can go to the Patreon page and find that out. But any support from a dollar on up is greatly appreciated. Absolutely. We truly do mean that. It means a lot to us. Go to patreon.com/TatooineSons. You can find us all over social media. Just look for @TatooineSons. Just search it on whatever social media except for Snapchat because I don't know how to use that. And we'd love for you guys to give us some reviews. If you're on iTunes, Stitcher, Spreaker, any of those, Spotify, please take a few moments to support family-friendly podcasting so that others know that it's out there. I guess that's going to pretty much do it. Anything else you guys want to say?
May the Force be with you.
May the Force be with you.
May the Force be with you, always.
This party's over.
I like that Wookiee.
Don't get technical with me.
Droid, please.
Yep, yep.
Tatooine Sons, the Star Wars podcast, is not endorsed by Lucasfilm Limited or Disney and is intended for entertainment and information purposes only. The official Star Wars site is located at www.starwars.com. Star Wars, the Star Wars logo, and all names and pictures of Star Wars characters, vehicles, and any other Star Wars-related items are registered trademarks and or copyrights of Lucasfilm Limited or their respective trademark and copyright holders.